mighty name we pray. We have come here this morning to the presence of the Lord. Want you to commit yourself to the hand of the Lord, that the Lord will bless your soul. Your coming here will not be in vain, and you will not go back the way that you have come. Why not commit yourself to the Lord, that the Lord will help you this morning. You receive the touch of the Lord upon your life, and that as you have come, you go back rejoicing, you go back renewed, you go back revived, and you go back with the joy of the Lord in your heart, and you have a testimony of the touch of God upon your soul, of the touch of God upon your life. Jesus' mighty name we pray. A better amen than that. Our Father, we thank you because our prayers are answered. We ask that this morning in your presence, demonstrate your power. Have your way in this place. And we pray that nobody will escape the sword of your blessing. Thank you for answer to prayer, Lord. Jesus' mighty name we pray. And amen. Please let's be seated. We are all welcome to our combined service this morning of service group 2 in Jesus' name. We want to welcome into our midst this morning all those who may be coming to our midst for the first time. If today is the first time you are coming to our midst to worship with us, this is Deeper Life Bible Church headquarters, Bagada. You have been invited by a friend, by a neighbor, or at one time or the other, you have been directed here. Wherever you are in our midst this morning, we want you to raise up your hand. If you are here for the first time, can you please raise up your hand wherever you are? Please, can you raise up your hand wherever you are? As you are raising up your hand, can you please rise up upon your feet? God bless you. You are all welcome in Jesus' name. Our Father in the Lord, the General Superintendent of Deeper Life Bible Church, and the whole congregation, they welcome you into our midst. We want you to continue to come as you are here for the first time. And as you continue to come, the blessings of the Lord will abide more and more in your life. And as God has used it to be a blessing unto us, yours will not be an exception. Our leaders and ushers are very close to you, and they will give you a slip to fill, a package. Please take it from them. Complete the information therein in the slip, and thereafter, you can sit down. At the end of the service, I want to plead that you come to the front seat by my right hand side after the service this morning, so that some of our leaders and pastors will meet with you very briefly. The vehicles that brought you will also wait to take you back home. Other announcements, our weekly meetings. We normally have three important meetings in our church, the Deeper Bible Church. On Sunday, we have what we call the Sunday worship service, which starts by 7:45 a.m. in all our districts and location churches. Then we have the Monday Bible study, which is the backbone of the church. Our Monday Bible study starts in our various districts and locations. And when we are also having it combined here in our headquarters church by 5:45 p.m. every Monday. We have the revival service on Thursday, also in our various districts and locations. And the time for our revival service in our various districts is 6 p.m. We want that you will take this opportunity of these various opportunities of services that the Lord has given us in this church, and that by the grace of God, you will continue to come to get the best from the Lord. As we continue in this program this morning, the blessings of the Lord be the mighty upon our lives.
be faithful. I've never had to walk this long and winding road alone.
Down a familiar path, no matter where I'm at.
On sunny days or when I face the storm,
Jesus keeps guiding.
Before the Sunday message today, we shall have a brief period of scripture reading.
The First Epistle General of Peter, Chapter 2. Wherefore, laying aside all malice, and all guile, and hypocrisies, and envies, and all evil speakings, as newborn babes, desire the sincere milk of the word, that ye may grow thereby. If so be ye have tasted that the Lord is gracious. To whom coming, as unto a living stone, disallowed indeed of men, but chosen of God and precious, ye also, as lively stones, are built up a spiritual house, an holy priesthood, to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God by Jesus Christ. Wherefore also it is contained in the scripture, Behold, I lay in Zion a chief cornerstone, elect, precious, and he that believeth on him shall not be confounded. Unto you therefore which believe, he is precious. But unto them which be disobedient, the stone which the builders disallowed, the same is made the head of the corner, and a stone of stumbling, and a rock of offense, even to them which stumble at the word, being disobedient, whereunto also they were appointed. But ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, an holy nation, a peculiar people, that ye should show forth the praises of him who hath called you out of darkness into his marvelous light, which in time past were not a people, but are now the people of God, which had not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy. Dearly beloved, I beseech you as strangers and pilgrims, abstain from fleshly lusts, which war against the soul, having your conversation honest among the Gentiles, that whereas they speak against you as evildoers, they may by your good works, which they shall behold, glorify God in the day of visitation. Submit yourselves to every ordinance of man for the Lord's sake, whether it be to the king as supreme, or unto governors, as unto them that are sent by him, for the punishment of evildoers, and for the praise of them that do well. For so is the will of God, that with well-doing ye may put to silence the ignorance of foolish men. As free, and not using your liberty for a cloak of maliciousness, but as the servants of God. Honor all men. Love the brotherhood. Fear God. Honor the king. Servants, be subject to your masters with all fear, not only to the good and gentle, but also to the froward. For this is thankworthy, if a man for conscience toward God endure grief, suffering wrongfully. For what glory is it, if when ye be buffeted for your faults, ye shall take it patiently? But if when ye do well and suffer for it, ye take it patiently, this is acceptable with God. For even hereunto were ye called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that ye should follow his steps, who did no sin, neither was guile found in his mouth, who, when he was reviled, reviled not again. When he suffered, he threatened not, but committed himself to him that judgeth righteously, who, his own self, bare our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, being dead to sins, should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes ye were healed. For ye were as sheep going astray, but are now returned unto the shepherd and bishop of your souls. Chapter 3. Likewise, ye wives, be in subjection to your own husbands, that if any obey not the word, they also may without the word be won by the conversation of the wives, while they behold your chaste conversation coupled with fear. Whose adorning, let it not be that outward adorning of plaiting the hair, and of wearing of gold, or of putting on of apparel, but let it be the hidden man of the heart, in that which is not corruptible, even the ornament of a meek and quiet spirit, which is in the sight of God of great price. For after this manner, in the old time, the holy women also who trusted in God adorned themselves, being in subjection unto their own husbands. Even as Sarah obeyed Abraham, calling him Lord, whose daughters ye are, as long as ye do well, and are not afraid with any amazement. Likewise, ye husbands, dwell with them according to knowledge, giving honor unto the wife as unto the weaker vessel, and as being heirs together of the grace of life, that your prayers be not hindered. Finally, be ye all of one mind, having compassion one of another. Love as brethren, be pitiful, be courteous, not rendering evil for evil or railing for railing, but contrariwise blessing, knowing that ye are thereunto called, that ye should inherit a blessing. For he that will love life and see good days, let him refrain his tongue from evil, and his lips that they speak no guile. Let him eschew evil and do good. Let him seek peace and ensue it. For the eyes of the Lord are over the righteous, and his ears are open unto their prayers. but the face of the Lord is against them that do evil. And who is he that will harm you if ye be followers of that which is good? But, and if ye suffer for righteousness' sake, happy are ye, and be not afraid of their terror, neither be troubled. But sanctify the Lord God in your hearts, and be ready always to give an answer to every man that asketh you a reason of the hope that is in you with meekness and fear, having a good conscience, that whereas they speak evil of you as of evildoers, they may be ashamed that falsely accuse your good conversation in Christ. For it is better, if the will of God be so, that ye suffer for well-doing than for evil-doing. For Christ also hath once suffered for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but quickened by the Spirit, by which also he went and preached unto the spirits in prison, which sometime were disobedient, when once the long-suffering of God waited in the days of Noah, while the ark was a-preparing, wherein few, that is, 8 souls, were saved by water. The like figure, whereunto even baptism doth also now save us, not the putting away of the filth of the flesh, but the answer of a good conscience toward God, by the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who is gone into heaven, and is on the right hand of God, angels and authorities and powers being made subject unto him.
May God help us to be stewards of the word. Amen.
In the heart of the nature's gift to the nation, state where the sun paints the horizon with hues of hope.
A global phenomenon is set to unfold.
We're going to Taraba. Before we get there, you, yourself, you have a foretaste of Taraba.
2024 is a unique and a different year. And the package that God has got for you because of this crusade, you can never underestimate it.
Get ready for another transformative event of the year.
The Global Retreat and the Global Crusade with Kumuyi this Easter in Taraba State, Nigeria.
From the 28th of March to the 2nd of April.
Join us for a divine encounter like never before.
This isn't just a crusade.
It's a spiritual awakening with a theme, the all-sufficient Jesus.
The name of Jesus, there is wonder in that name. There is power in that name. There is dominion in that name.
The venue, Government Secondary School, Wukari, Taraba State,
will be the epicenter of a miraculous convergence.
A perfect combination just for you.
The Global Retreat and Crusade.
A time for reflection,
renewal,
and spiritual rejuvenation. Under the serene Taraba sky, we'll rediscover the true meaning of season as the sun sets. The crusade begins, a symphony of salvation,
healing, restoration, and deliverance.
Experience the divine power that transcends and dispels sin, sickness, and the shackles of darkness.
Also featuring Jesus Aglow in Me, a youth impact program on the 2nd of April, 8 a.m. Nigerian time.
Follow us on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, and subscribe to our YouTube channels. Also, download our radio app for further updates and for your online participation.
Join us in the northeastern Nigeria
this Easter as we embrace the divine together, because in the presence of the all-sufficient Jesus, miracles happen.
now bring you choir ministrations from regions, states, and nations across the world.
Thank you. Preach the gospel. Go to all the world so everyone can hear. Tell them Jesus Christ the Lord will soon be coming. We can see the by the signs, the time is near.
We'll tell the world.
Jesus is the only way.
I said, praise the Lord. I welcome everyone to our service this morning in Jesus' name. Those who are here, those who are there, everywhere, I pray the blessing of the Lord will be upon every life, even today and your families too, in Jesus' name. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for this hour. What a great day and a great time. We're asking, O Lord, that the sunshine of your truth will come to every heart, even today, in Jesus' name. Do for us in this service what no man, what no other person on earth can do. Thank you, Lord, for the answer. In Jesus' name we pray. And the headquarters church said, amen. Amen. God bless you. You can sit down. Today we're coming to that same passage we studied at the time of searching the scriptures together. We're looking at Exodus chapter 18. And I'm reading from verse 1. When Jethro, the priest of Midian, it says, Moses' father-in-law, heard of all that God had done for Moses and for Israel, his people, and that the Lord had brought Israel out of Egypt. Look at verse 2. In verse 2, it said, then Jethro, Moses' father-in-law, took Zipporah, Moses' wife, after he had sent her back. And then in verse 3, it tells us, and her two sons, of which the name of the one was Gershom. And for he said, I have been an alien in a strange land. And then in verse 4, it tells us, it says, and the name of the other son was Eliezer. And for God, the God of my father, said he was mine help, and delivered me from the sword of Pharaoh. Look at verse 5. In verse 5 it says, and Jethro, Moses' father-in-law, came with his sons and his wife unto Moses into the wilderness, where he encamped at the mount of God. Verse 6 tells us, it says, and he said unto Moses, I, thy father-in-law Jethro, am come unto thee, and thy wife and her two sons with her. Verse 7 tells us, it says, and Moses went out to meet his father-in-law, and did obeisance, and kissed him. And they asked each other of the new covenant, the new testament. I'm talking about reconciliation and progress in the family. In our lives, personal lives, reconciliation and progress. In our spiritual life, as we come to the Lord, we're born again, we're saved, and we're united with the Lord. Reconciliation and progress. And in society at large, if we're going to have any progress, reconciliation and progress on our way to heaven, everything begins with the reconciliation. Reconciliation and progress. The children of Israel that left the land of Egypt, they were brought out by the mighty power of God. When I see the blood, I will pass over you. And that was the point of their spiritual, initial, important, essential, indispensable reconciliation. Every other kind of reconciliation that may take place, organized, orchestrated by anybody on earth, without that false reconciliation with God, will mean nothing in eternity. And so as we talk about reconciliation, the question is, have you been reconciled with the Almighty God in heaven? Have you come out of your Egypt, out of your sin, out of your evil, and you have come unto the Lord? And you're on your way to the promised land, reconciliation. You repent. You turn to the Lord. You are born again. Your sins are forgiven. Your life is changed. And all the hatred in you before, everything is turned to love. You realize the love of God. And you realize He has taken you out of darkness into the marvelous light of His own begotten Son. Reconciliation. And it is only then, as a person, it's only then, as a believer, you can begin to make a progress. Now you're saved, you're made righteous, your life is clean, your life is pure, and now you're on your way to Canaan land, the promised land. You're on your way to heaven, paradise. And so we have reconciliation every step of the way. You're making progress in your personal life. And now if you are married, there is reconciliation. And the reconciliation doesn't mean your wife has been far away somewhere in Midian, and here you are around Kadesh Barnea, and then somebody travels all the way from Midian, and then you are reconciled. Maybe that happens to you, that your wife has been away, far away, but you can be living in the same house, and in your mind, you are far apart. Your mind is over there. Your wife's mind is over there. In your interaction, walking together, you're going this direction. She is going that other direction. And we need reconciliation in the family, that they will be one. Because it says, for this cause shall a man leave his father and leave his mother. Now, you can leave your father and leave your mother in the physical. Your father is far away there. Your mom is far away there. But your mind is always with them. You have not really left them. You're still their baby. You're still their boy. You're still their girl. And while your husband is there in the physical, in the natural, and you can see, you're even eating on the same table, you're all the time looking at the text that mommy sent you, that daddy sent you. You're still their boy, you're still their girl, and while you're discussing with your wife, you're absent-minded. Why? Because your mind is over there. You have not left father and mother, and you're not cleaving to your wife. You're not cleaving to your husband. You need reconciliation, that we love one another, and there is no barrier, there is no barricade, there is no wall of demarcation between the husband and the wife. We need reconciliation. Here we are in the church. The leader in the church and the members in the church, the teacher of the word of God and the learners and the followers, we need reconciliation. And it is that reconciliation that makes us to make progress. Otherwise, the teacher, the preacher, the pastor is preaching and teaching, and your mind is talking or is thinking of something he said 4 weeks ago, and I don't appreciate that. My mind is not, I'm still thinking of that. I hope he comes back and he points at me and he looks at me and said, okay, don't mind, I am sorry. Otherwise, let him keep on preaching. We are not together. We need reconciliation in life. Everything of progress depends on reconciliation. In the case of Moses and the people of Israel, they had Jethro. And Jethro came and he brought Zipporah, the wife of Moses, and brought the two sons. And now he said, I came so that I can leave your son, your wife, with you. That's reconciliation. And then he also, in the reconciliation, he was very helpful to Moses. What is it you're doing here that I see? He said, I'm counseling the people, I'm teaching the people. If they have a matter, they bring that matter to me and I resolve the conflict between them. You have millions of members, you alone. If you're sitting there, you are not going to be able to endure for a long time. You are more than 80 years of age, and if you want to slow down your progress or your speech to the point of death, slow down. You can delegate and choose this and this and this and that for 4 levels of leadership and put them in charge, and then you can relax. You need rest. You need relaxation. You need some sleep too, so that your life will be longer. Thank you very much, Jethro. And Jethro said, do this so that you will live and your lifespan will be longer, and then you will be healthy and strong. If the Lord leads you to do that, what a great and a good counselor. In the world, we have counselors, great counselors. But the pity is, as for Jethro, Jethro was not redeemed, saved, reconciled to the God of Israel. He was a foreigner, a Midianite, the priest of Midian, but he gave good advice. That's true. We have the marriage counselors in the world, and sometimes from experience and from reading many books, they give good counsel. We have the helpers in the world, and even have ministries, and they have organization, they have a company, and they have their levels of counseling. But Jethro, with all his counseling, he didn't get to the land of promise. He wasn't even willing to. He wasn't willing to go with them to the land of promise. But in our own case, thank God, our counselor is greater than Jethro. I was waiting for a good amen. Jethro, who is our counselor? Greater, higher, more intelligent, wiser than Jethro. Look at that, Jethro. J is our justifying judge. He is our justifying judge. Jesus is the one that comes, and he's going to reconcile us with the Father, and he's going to give us the progress we ought to have, and then all the bad things that were in our lives, he justifies us so that we'll not face the judgment on the final day. He is the justifying judge. Jethro couldn't do that for anyone in Israel. He there is the emancipating Emmanuel. His name is Emmanuel, and he's the one that emancipates us and liberates us, and he breaks every yoke, even greater yokes than that of Pharaoh. He is our emancipating Emmanuel. And as you look at that name, Jethro, you have a T there. This is the transforming teacher. We know that thou art a teacher come from heaven. Jethro came from Midian, a Midianite, and a priest of the Midianites, but our own counselor, our own redeemer, the one that has come to give us everlasting counsel that will lead us to the place we ought to be. He is our emancipating Emmanuel. He is our transforming teacher, and he is the truth that sets us free, the emancipating truth that calms our lives. Have you seen the H there? Jesus Christ is our helper and healer. Our helper and healer. Healing the wounds of the mind, family, healing, all the things that trouble us, that Jesus is greater than Jethro in every way. Are there? He is the reconciling Redeemer. He reconciles us with God. He reconciles us even with ourselves. He reconciles us with our neighbors. He reconciles us with everyone. He is the reconciling Redeemer. Oh, the only overcomer. And he comes to live in our heart. He says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him. And then he said, because I overcame, you will overcome. The only overcomer that can enter into us. And then it says, greater is he than he that is in the world. And that's the reason why we're here. If it were for Jethro alone, you wouldn't be there. But because of Jesus, the one greater than Jethro of that time, and greater than any Jethro of this time, he comes. He comes to help us. He will help you. He will take us to heaven. And once he makes reconciliation for us with the Father, and then he gives us grace upon grace, help upon help, and he helps us, and every step of the way, every day in the journey, he'll lead us through, he'll lead you through, he'll lead me through, in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm talking about reconciliation and progress in the family. We're dividing the message to three parts today. Number one, the peaceful reconciliation with Moses' spouse, that's his wife, and his family. Number two, the patient restoration of Moses' sons to the faith. It's one thing to bring the wife and bring the sons. Are they in the faith? Where will they be? What will be their position in Israel? And where will they be in eternity? The patient restoration of Moses' sons to the faith. Number three is the prioritized retraining. There's something we need to prioritize in our families, with our wives, with our husband, with our children, with our sons. There's something that the priority we ought to have. The priority of taking these sons, and they brought them from Midian, and now reshaping them, retraining them, refocusing them, so that they will be on their way to heaven. Prioritize retraining of malleable sons for fruitfulness. You don't want them to be dependent upon the father, upon the mother, upon the handouts from other children of Israel all the days of their lives. What have they been doing in Midian? Where have they been in Midian? And what is their usefulness to themselves? In now that they come back to the Father, we need to prioritize their training, because they're still malleable sons for fruitfulness. Look at number one, we're looking at peaceful reconciliation with Moses' spouse and his family. We've read the passage already. Look at three things here. Number one, we're looking at the foundation of reconciliation in the family. Number two is the transformational forgiveness, the kind of forgiveness that transforms the husband, the kind of forgiveness that transforms the wife, the kind of forgiveness that transforms the sons and the members of the family. Transformational forgiveness and reunion in faithfulness. Number three, the transparent fellowship with reciprocity without falsehood. Now we're back together, Moses and Zipporah. And now we relate together. And, Zipporah had been far away, influenced by foreign ideas. But now you come home, and you leave the foreign ideas and the foreign opinions and the foreign culture, you leave that behind. Now that we're together, this fellowship and this relationship must be transparent, and we have reciprocity. Without the falsehood, somebody could have brought from the foreign world. Look at that, number one now. Number one is the foundation of reconciliation. What's the foundation of reconciliation? Husband and wife together until death do us part. That's the foundation for reconciliation. Because the plan of God and the program of God and the project of God is that husband and wife should be together, and they should not separate, and they should not turn their backs one against the other. One should not be over there, another one far away. That's the reason for reconciliation. That's why we consider, all right, apart, we're not in the will of God. Together, we are in the plan of God. It says in Malachi chapter 2, and I'm reading there from verse 14. Malachi chapter 2, we're looking at verse 14. Yet ye say, wherefore? Because the Lord hath been witness between thee and the wife of thy youth, against whom thou hast dealt treacherously, yet she is thy companion. You have dealt treacherously. You have sent her away. You are now separated. Yet, in the mind of God, she is thy companion. And yet, she is the wife of thy youth. In verse 15, it tells us, and did not he make one? Did he not glue you together? Did he not join you together? Did he not make one? Yet had he the residue of the Spirit. And wherefore one? Therefore, take heed. It says that he might seek a godly seed. Therefore, take heed to your spirit. Your spirit telling you, we're not compatible. This woman is not going to help me in my business, and she is not going to help me in my progress. Be careful of the thoughts you nurse in your spirit. And then it says, and let none deal treacherously against the wife of his youth. In verse 16 it says, for the Lord the God of Israel says that he hateth putting away. That's the foundation of the reconciliation. God says, I hate putting away. And God is still the same. Everything that he had before, he still has now. The hatred he has for the separation and for the divorce and for the putting away, he still has now. He says in verse 16, the Lord, the God of Israel, says that he hateth putting away, for one covereth violence with his garment, says the Lord of hosts. Therefore, take heed to your spirit, that ye deal not treacherously. Matthew chapter 19, they were reading from verse 4. Matthew chapter 19, verse 4, and he answered and said unto them, Pharisees, Sadducees, born again or not born again, he says unto all, have ye not read that he which made them at the beginning made them male one and female one? Male, female, man, woman, one husband, one wife. And then it says in verse 5, and said, for this cause shall a man, one man, leave father, one father, and mother, one mother, and shall cleave unto his wife, one wife. and they twain, they two shall be one flesh. And then in verse 6 it says, wherefore there no more two, there no more twain, but one flesh. What therefore God has joined together, let not man put asunder. That's the foundation of the reconciliation in the family. Number two, we're looking at the transformational forgiveness and reunion in faithfulness. Now, when two people come together, husband and wife, a lot of things may happen. You're coming from different backgrounds. You don't have the same IQ. You don't have the same intelligence. And you don't have the same evaluation on everything that happens. You elevate circumcision. Moses, the woman knows nothing about circumcision. And circumcision is very important to an Israelite and to a Moses. But for Zipporah, that was a bloody thing. Who gave you that? Who told you to do that? It was painful. It was bloody. I never heard of that in my father's house. Those two things could divide you. You count something important. You count it essential. You count it something you cannot do without. The other person says, what the use of this? I don't know the use of this. It doesn't have any importance to me. What you count important, she counts irrelevant. And because of importance, waging war with irrelevance, there's no peace. But now you forgive. She forgives you for what you count indispensable and important, and you forgive her for what she counts irrelevant, unimportant. And now that forgiveness must be transformational. It transforms you. It transforms me. And because the forgiveness is transformational, you have a reunion that you are faithful to each other. We're looking at Matthew chapter 18. We're looking at verse 21. In Matthew chapter 18, verse 21, then came Peter to him and said, Lord, how oft shall my brother, my sister, my wife, my husband, my neighbor, our member, how often shall my brother sin against me and I forgive him? And before allowing Christ to answer the question, 7 times, isn't that enough? Look at what will count as offense between husband and wife. Keeping the house, taking care of your clothes, preparing the food, taking care of the children, taking care of you the way your mother took care of your father. And then being the last to take anything in the house, the way your mother will prepare for the house and for the home to be nice for everybody, but except herself. And you grew up with that, and now you are married. And what you are, every time the wife does something, you kind of compare that with what mommy used to do. And kneeling down whenever mommy was greeting daddy. And when daddy came back from work, you know, the attitude. And mommy would put everything aside, even what she was cooking, or, you know, in the kitchen. And then come to take the bag of daddy. You loved that. When I marry, I'll be looking for a wife like that. You're married, and your wife is not coming from that background. Your wife came from the background of daddy and mommy. You know, she goes to work and he goes to work, and then they come back. Whoever comes back first will begin to prepare food. My my daddy did not steal. My daddy never stepped into the kitchen, but you know her own daddy. She will carry that and carry that, and he will do this and that, and now you are married. You are from different backgrounds. And those backgrounds begin to conflict one with the other. And now you are you're taking offense because of those offenses. You took offense and she went over the fence. You're separated because of those things. Now there's reconciliation. You are born again and she is born again. And you are now together. And you need to reorientate yourself. Transform yourself. And don't look at what daddy and mommy used to do. Look at what Jesus Christ has given to his own people. And he said, not till seven times. But look at verse 22. Jesus says unto him, I say not unto thee until seven times, but until 70 times seven. That's difficult to calculate in the family, because when a wife offends us, we don't say, okay, excuse me, then go to the register and put the date and put the number of the offense. And then another time, maybe the following day, you're trying to say something and she didn't allow you to land. She already starts talking. Let me finish before you answer me. Why? 50-50. You talk, I talk. And if you keep on talking, I may forget what you have said, that I need to, you know, put a question mark on. You're offended. Then you rise up from there, go to your register. Number two, you can't do that. And so how do you know 70 times 7? Just forgive. Let it transform you, that the things that used to bother you will not bother you anymore. The things you cannot change in your wife, her height, her intonation, her understanding, her reasoning, her logic, her being illogical, all that we bring to the world with us. I happen to know mathematics, I do analyze it a lot. My wife, like many of our people, you know, at school, mathematics was not their issue. But she types, and my outlines, message outlines, I do that with my kind of writing, and she can decipher everything and do the typing. I cannot type. And she does not analyze like a mathematician. We're different, but we've come to learn and to know each other. The same thing you ought to do, that you learn and you know each other. Whatever at the beginning of your marriage you were offended with, now you are a student in that marriage. You now forgive until 70 times 7. The grace of God multiply in every life in Jesus' name. I'm coming to number 3 here. Number 3 here, we're looking at transparent fellowship with reciprocity without falsehood. We have the fellowship one with another, and fellowship means love. Fellowship means that you consider her and she considers you. We're looking at Matthew chapter 7 and we're looking at verse 12. Here is the very basis of true fellowship. Therefore, all things whatsoever ye would that men should do to you, do ye even so to them. For this is the law and the prophets. You see, maybe you've not read from Genesis to Exodus to Leviticus to Numbers to Deuteronomy to the end of Malachi. But it says all that the prophets are saying, all that those teachers are saying, with those doctrines, your relationship to God, your relationship to man, everything is a kind of contained in this. All things all things ye would whatsoever that your wife should do to you. You man, if you were the wife, how would you behave? How will you respond? And you woman, if you were the husband, what would you expect that she would do unto you? Now before you do anything whatsoever, my wife likes this. My wife does not like this. When I say this, even though it's the truth, it goes the wrong way. And I've learned my lesson. Have you learned your lesson? My husband does not appreciate this, and it doesn't please her. It breaks our fellowship. It destroys our togetherness. Whenever he talks like this to me, and my wife does not like referring to the members of her family, born again or not born again, it doesn't like you casting aspersions of members of her family. And the man, he doesn't like you to say, is that what your mother was cooking when you were younger? I give you better food here. My husband doesn't like that. Is that the way your father was eating? He prefers to eat with his son. And then, you know, even when I was an infant, my parents taught me to eat with knife and fork. My husband doesn't like that kind of comment. It's like you belittle my family. Now, we notice whatsoever you want her to do to you, do to her as well. And whatsoever you want him to say to you, say that as well. That's how we have fellowship. And when you say that innocently, and you say that with transparency, truly in your heart, you're forgetting all those other things, and everything you can say that will pinch her and pick her and break her and also go the wrong way, you've made them to go with the water under the bridge. Now you are transparent, and there is fellowship. You know, as somebody, you used to go out, you're going to work, she knows I'm going to work. That's how I feed the family. And so, but she wasn't around in the sitting room. She was at the sitting room, she knows I'm going to work, and then you've gone. And then your wife comes back. Where's daddy? Where's daddy? And then searches everywhere, and it's gone, why does this man do like that? Cannot even have the courtesy and the respect and the love to say, darling, I'm going to work. Look at the time now. Thank you very much. Have a great day. Have a nice day. He doesn't do that. Why don't we learn? And why don't we just understand? Here is fellowship. I'm going someplace. I'll come back at this time. And now in the days of this thing you hold in your hand, what do you call it? Tell me, remind me. You don't know? Tell me now. In this day of, you know, mobile telephone, everybody has, if you are coming back late, it doesn't hurt you. It won't take 1 minute, call her. You know, the traffic is heavy. I'll be coming back late. All those little things, they help us in defining fellowship, in refining our fellowship. And so we have transparent fellowship. If you happen to be with a man, you happen to be with a woman in your office, and maybe you have to do some work, and you know, as if your wife was there. And if she's not there, either when you come back home, you say, you know what we did today? I saw this man, I saw that woman, and we did this and we did that. That doesn't hurt anybody. And all those little things, they make us to have fellowship. Well, we'll have fellowship. I said we'll have fellowship. Did you see what Moses did? Moses sat down with Jethro, the father-in-law. We don't know whether the wife was there or not, but whatever Jethro was thinking, after these many years of separation, my husband loves my father. And that does a lot. And then Moses told him everything they have gone through. And Jethro also said, you know, in your absence, this is what had been happening. They had good communication together. That's what we need to do. They are not difficult. And with the grace of God in our lives and with reconciliation with God, I believe things are going to become better. Your life, better family. In your home, better family. Now, with the children, so we need fellowship. Daddy, you've been a mathematician, and now look at the two sons that you have, the sons that were brought back. They know nothing of mathematics. Mathematics is not the in thing. The great thing in Midian, construction and all that, that's not the great thing in Midian. But Egypt, where Moses was coming from, they taught them mathematics, they taught them archaeology, and they taught them architecture, they taught them everything. And now the children have come back, and you see that they know next to nothing. Just spend a few minutes every day and sit down with them. That's fellowship. That you are saying, okay, that's how they do this, that's how they do this, that's how they calculate, that's how they calculate. It's not that when the children come, you've been so busy, the children have slept before you came back home. And you're so dutiful, you've gone out of the house before the children wake up. Help them. And know them, know their strong points, and know their weak points, and know how to tailor them and train them. Your family will make progress. Say the amen that you are going to work on. But come now, it says, therefore, all things whatsoever you would that men should do to you, that your husband should do to you, that your wife should do to you, that your children should do to you, that your parents should do to you, do even so to them, for this is the law and the prophets. We're coming to point number two here. Point number two, we're coming to patient restoration of Moses' sons to the faith. We're looking at three things. Number one, we're looking at returning circumcised to the faith of their father. Returning, now they have brought them back, but they were still circumcised. Number two, restored, circumcised to the faith with fruit. Number three, reckoned, circumcised among the faithful fully. Let's look at number one there. Number one, returning circumcised to the faith of their father. We're told in Exodus chapter 18, and we're reading from verse 2. It says, and then Jethro, Moses' father-in-law, took Zipporah, Moses' wife, after he had sent her back. And then he tells us in verse 5, and Jethro, Moses' father-in-law, came with his sons and his wife unto Moses into the wilderness where he encamped at the Mount of God. Now think about the coming back of the sons. If those sons were not circumcised, they will not be accepted into the commonwealth of Israel. Let's understand that. Because the Lord had told Abraham that every son that is born to any of the families of his descendants must be circumcised. If that son is not circumcised, be cut off from the people of Israel. And actually, what brought the rift between the wife and Moses is that as he was coming back, the Lord wanted to get rid of that son that was not circumcised. And Zipporah knew they had been arguing about it at home. I need to circumcise the child. You will never circumcise the child. All of us Israelites, we must be circumcised as men. You are not in Israel anymore. Here you are in Midian. And the woman did not know she was still going to go to the people of Israel. She thought, you will die here in Midian. Circumcision, never. And so as the Lord wanted to deal with that uncircumcised situation, the boy to die, Zipporah understood and quickly took his sharp stone and circumcised the child. And the circumcision remained. The circumcision remained. Before you can be counted as part of the people of God, coming back physically is not enough. There must be the circumcision of your heart. Now, those children could have reversed their circumcision. How? Look at this, 1 Corinthians chapter 7. I'm reading from the first part of verse 18. 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 18. Is any man called being circumcised? Let him not become uncircumcised. And those sons had not reversed their circumcision, so they were brought back circumcised. Look at number two. Number two is talking about restored, circumcised to the faith with fruit. Restored to the people of Israel, but remaining circumcised with faith and fruit. It tells us in Genesis chapter 17, and I'm reading from verse 13. Genesis 17 verse 13, he that is born in thy house, or he that is bought with thy money, must needs to be circumcised, and my covenant shall be in your flesh for an everlasting covenant. In verse 14, and the uncircumcised man child whose flesh of his foreskin is not circumcised, that soul shall be cut off from the people. He has broken my covenant. He has broken my covenant. Actually, that was leading to the circumcision of the heart. In Deuteronomy chapter 30, and reading from verse 6. Deuteronomy chapter 30, verse 6. And the Lord thy God will circumcise thine heart. Now, you circumcise the flesh. You do what you can do. You do what the Lord has commanded for you to do. Circumcise every man child. And after you've done that, now the Lord will do what you cannot do, which he will do. We check up in our lives. There are many things God says he will do. And a number of things he has said we must do. We cannot save ourselves, but we can repent. And when we do what we can do, then he saves us. But if we don't do our part, he will not do his part. It will sanctify us, but we must thirst and hunger after righteousness. And then he will give us the righteousness of faith. We must set apart ourselves. We must consecrate ourselves. Then he will sanctify and purify us. We do what we can do. They did what they could do, the circumcision of the flesh. And now he does what only he can do. The Lord thy God will circumcise thine heart. and the heart of thy seed to love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy soul, that thou mayest live. The Lord circumcise every one of us in the heart in Jesus' name. At number 3.